Jesus came forth to be born of a virgin, dwelt among men. My example is he. The Word became flesh and the light shined among us. His glory revealed.
Living, he loved me. Dying, he saved me. Buried, he carried my sins far away. Rising, he justified freely forever. One day he's coming, a glorious day,
a glorious day. One day they led him a Calvary's mountain. One day they nailed him to die on a tree. Suffering, anguish, despised and rejected, bearing our sins, my Redeemer is he. The hand that held nations stretched out on a tree. One day the grave could conceal him no longer. One day the stone rolled away from the door. Then he arose over death he had conquered. Now is ascended, my Lord evermore. Death could not hold him. The grave could not.
As we think about the cross, we look at the empty tomb here. We celebrate on Sunday, but we also look even further ahead to when he's coming again, because the story continues. We're going to continue worship, but I'm going to ask you to go ahead and be seated for a few moments as we sing this next song. Feel free to listen or to sing with us either way, but it really is a reminder of what it took to empty the tomb, overcoming death after taking the weight of our sin, because we were all in prison. We were all in a tomb of death, yet because of what Christ has done, we are set free.
Shame is a prison as cruel as a grave. Shame is a robber and he's come to take my name. Love is my redeemer, lifting me up from the ground. Love is the power where my freedom song is found. There ain't no
Yeah.
stand before you as those who are redeemed. Through no merit of our own, we haven't done anything except bring our death. Our sin that we're born with, we carry that. Yet, Lord, you broke the grave open from the inside with your own resurrection. On this day, every Sunday we celebrate your resurrection. And on this day, we're reminded that it was our death, our sin, our grave clothes that you took away. You paid our penalty on the cross and you gave us new life as the first fruits of our resurrection. So we praise you as your people. We glorify your name. And we thank you for the power of your resurrection that extends to all those who call on your name. In your name we pray. And all God's people said, amen and amen.
Amen. Well, Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Let's try that again. I'll say Christ is risen. You say he is risen indeed. Christ is risen. Do you know today over 2 billion people around the world did that call and response in their churches? Isn't it amazing to think that around the world today, not only in heaven, but all the way around the world, people are saying, Christ is risen.
He is risen
indeed. Amen and amen. Welcome to Grace Fellowship Church. If you're visiting with us today, I want to extend to you the warmest of welcomes. My name is Jason McKnight. I serve as the pastor here, and I love being part of this body of believers. It's just a great group of people trying to connect more to the Lord so that we can connect more to the world. And that's what we're all about here. Every few seats on you will have seen a little card, and it's a connect card because we want to give you an opportunity. If you're visiting, if you're new here, if you've been here for a week, a month, a year, but you've never really left a record and you want to reach out a little more, fill that card out. We'll give you a call this week and see how we can help you or serve you or meet you where you are. Connect card. On the back side of the connect card is a prayer card. Everyone here, if you have a prayer need that you want others, the elders and the ministry staff, to bring to the throne of grace, to ask God on your behalf, fill out that prayer card. Give thanks or a request or a need. Let us pray with you confidentially this week. We'll do it. What do you do with the connect card and the prayer card? Well, at the back by the paintings, there are two offering boxes, and you can drop that in there, and we'll take it from there to love you guys. Now, this is Easter Sunday. This is a special day. You see, we have the baptistry out at the end of our service. We're going to baptize folks, so be looking forward to that. The other thing, though, is parents, if you have children here, elementary school-aged, they're going to stay in the service today, and we're going to do a little something fun in a minute, but just instead of dismissing, usually, they'll stay in today. Of course, there's always the nursery for preschool and below. I want to tell you about three things coming up that are part of what we are as a family, as a body of believers, three ways that you can be involved or see what's happening or meet with others. And the first one is coming up on Wednesday, April 10th. We are doing a blood drive here. We do these maybe twice a year. And just if you want to give blood, go to your app with the Red Cross, make an appointment, and come and give blood. We hear that the Red Cross loves coming to this blood donor because y'all give tremendously. So thank you. That's really good to hear when they tell us that. They told us that last time. Then that's Wednesday on the 10th. That's 10 days from tomorrow. Then Friday evening, the 12th, if you have children, if you have students, rather, in middle school and high school, we want to invite you here to Grace for a parenting panel with a couple of families, a couple of couples who have gone through it and have wisdom to give. Some of it learned through mistakes, maybe. You know, but all of us love our kids, we love our students, the adults they're becoming, and we want to parent before the Lord and in community. And so, friends, if you have a chance, if you have middle school and high school students, come that evening, and you'll hear a little bit more about it as we go. And then, on the 20th of April, several churches in Lenoir County, including Grace, are sponsoring a Spirit of Lenoir Christian Music Fest down at Pearson Park. So that's going to be a great late afternoon into the early evening. It's going to be a rich time. Put that in your calendar. We're going to have a blast down there. Bring your own chair and come and worship the Lord with folks from different churches. It's just going to be great. Well, let me do this. You know, as we come together as a body, we give of our tithes and our offerings, and God loves that. He loves a cheerful giver. He doesn't love a grudging giver, but he loves a cheerful giver. What makes you cheerful is when you hope God will do something with it, right? because you're investing at that point. Well, let's do that. The same, not only money, but also time and service. Right now in the seed patch in the nursery, there are 15 people loving your kids so we can all worship together. They're serving. God loves a cheerful giver. And so as we give and as we serve, and then all of us together as we love each other, we're giving out. So let's ask God to bless and to multiply that. Pray with me. Father, it is a real honor to come into your house at your Spirit's leading, to come here and know that you have invited us and you have opened to us the way. And Lord, we also rejoice that you don't want passengers, but you want us to be, by your Spirit's power in us, partners in the gospel. And so through our giving and through our serving and through our loving, Lord, we hope, we count on you to do immeasurably more for your kingdom through our little investments. So will you do that, and will you bring us joy in it? We ask this day in Christ's name, amen. Well, I'm super excited to invite Amy Hooten, the new Grove director. Grove is our ministry to elementary and grade school age children in this hour. And instead of them going out, Amy, we want you to lead us in a little adventure today.
Well, good morning.
We're very excited.
We're not going to go swimming. Right. I hope we don't go swimming. That's not the plan, if everybody follows the plan. Good morning, everyone. How are you doing this morning? Good, 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 good. Isn't it a wonderful, beautiful day to celebrate our King, our Jesus? I would like for, I have a few volunteers that are going to come forward. I've already spoken with them. I have a few that are going to come forward. Come on, guys. Come on, come on, come on, come on. Cheer them on, cheer them on. Woo-hoo, woo-hoo. All right, all right, all right, all right. Now, everyone else that's Grove age, I would like for you to stand where you are so you can see really well. Stand, because you're going to be our cheering section. Stand up. Good job, guys. Okay, the rest of you can cheer on too, but I want them to stand so they can see. Tell us your name.
Whit.
Hello, Whit. Can everybody say good morning, Whit?
Good morning.
Okay, tell me your name.
Emelisa.
And Emelisa. Good morning, Emelisa. Tell me your name.
Easton.
Good morning, Easton.
Good morning.
And tell me your name.
Lucas.
Lucas. Good morning, Lucas.
Good morning, Lucas.
And tell me your name.
Elijah.
And good morning, Elijah.
Good morning, Elijah.
All right. Good job. Good job. Now, we're going to play a game, and you guys are going to help me with a demonstration because this game is so fun. Guess what? You're going to get to run and jump.
Yes.
In the church. We're not diving today, though. We're not diving. Not diving. Okay. Do you see the blue tape? You see the blue tape on the floor? Okay. I'm going to tell you. Great question. I'm glad you asked. We have three aisles. See the aisles? Okay. In our game, we have these three aisles. Have you ever played The Floor is Lava? Woohoo! So fun. Well, this, from the blue tape all the way up until you get to the top of the stage, even the brown part right here is lava. It's like an empty, it's either a bottomless pit or it's going to burn you up. So you'll fall forever or it's going to be, whoo, that would be bad, right? Ooh, ooh, ooh. So your goal, I'm going to let you start at the door when I tell you, your goal will be to run, jump, however you think you can, but you have to end up on the carpet. You cannot touch the stairs. You have to end up on this black gray carpet. Do you see it back here? Okay. Now, you may come down this aisle, you may come down this aisle, or you may come down this aisle. That's it. Yes, ma'am.
Wait, are we allowed to step on this?
You are allowed to step behind the blue, and then I want you to end up on top of the stage, on the top section. You think it might be hard? Okay. Now, I want you to make your way to the door. Quickly, quickly. Ladies and gentlemen, are we going to cheer them on today? Woohoo! Woohoo! All right. Now, I forgot this. There's a timer. There's a timer. Okay, you have to start at the door, touching the door. Now, you may not climb on the chairs. The aisle, blue tape, you may touch. Pass the blue tape, you're out if you touch the floor at all. You got it? Are you ready? On your mark, get set, go! Woo-hoo! 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 You may touch the blue tape. Time's up. Time's up. Oh, my. Was that a very fair game? Oh, okay. Let me check the rule book. Hold on. I've got the rules right here. Let me check the rule book and see. Because, guys, that was like impossible, right?
Yes.
Oh, my word. Okay. All right. So, lava, no chairs, aisles. Oh, here's one. Here's one. Oh, I can't believe I forgot to tell you this part. Ooh. Now, Mr. Kent is up here on stage. You see him? Okay. So, Mr. Kent, part of our rules, it says, Mr. Kent may come down from the stage. And he can be your safe person, your safe way. Okay? But, when he comes down and gets behind the blue, you must ask him to help you. He can't do it on his own. You must ask him. Do you understand that? You must what? Ask him. And as long as he's touching you or you're touching him, the floor's no longer lava. But you have to be with him. And you must what? Ask him. You think we can do it? Do you think it's doable this time? Woohoo! I can't believe I forgot that part. All right, go back to the doors. Hurry. You ready? Let's go. Touch the doors.
I don't understand.
Okay.
Like, how are we supposed to make it up there?
If you ask Mr. Kent, he'll help you. That's the point. Okay? So you have to ask, right? On your mark, get set, go. Woohoo! Go. You have to go, guys, go. Woohoo! Woohoo! Come here. Now tell me what you did.
I went up the rail.
And that looks like a good place, but was that part of the rules?
Wait, we couldn't go up there.
No.
Oops.
Sorry. You burned up, girl. You burned up. Can we give our volunteers a hand? Woohoo! Thank you, guys. Thank you. You may go back to your seat. Now, Miss Amy, what in the world? We're running around. We had a good time. We have a good time in the Grove, guys. But we're running around. What does this have to do with Easter? Let me tell you, I'm glad you asked. Now, we have a rule book. Does anybody know what our instruction book is for life? The Bible. Good job. Our Bible tells us that God is completely holy. He is fully, completely holy. And sin cannot be in his presence. This pit, this lava, represents the result of sin, the punishment for sin. And there's no way on earth that in our lives from our birth to when our bodies stop working that we can do enough good things, that we could try hard enough to get over the punishment for sin. So God, in his book of instructions, said that he would come down and he would take care of all that punishment. And he would come to earth. And that's what we celebrate, is he took our punishment, he died, and he rose again. That's what we celebrate on Easter. But this is the key. He did it, but we have to ask him. We have to turn away from sin. That's called repentance. And ask him, be my Savior. And not only will he take us to heaven when our bodies stop working, but he'll also help us on the journey before then. How do you like that game? Was that a fun game? Thank you so much. Guys, give them a round of applause again. Thank you so much. Let's have a word of prayer. Lord God, we just dedicate each one of these young people to you, Lord, and we just ask you to draw them to yourself at an early age. Circumcise their hearts for you, to love you, to live for you, and to serve you, Lord God. At the end of our lives here, when we stop breathing on this earth, that we will be with you, and we thank you for that opportunity. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Thank you.
Thank you, Miss Amy. Thank you, kids, for being a part of that. What a great visual. And as we think about the resurrection, we think what Christ did and the power of that. We also look ahead. Where is Christ now? He's seated at heaven's throne, isn't he? With all the saints who've gone before us and all the angels, myriads and myriads, says John in the book of Revelation, are worshiping him. And that's what we're doing. We're doing the same thing. We're singing holy of his holiness. We're singing of his kingly reign. We're singing hallelujahs to the one who has made a way for us to cross that chasm of sin. Would you stand with us together, church, as we lift our voices once again, praising the one who reigns from heaven's throne. Sang a new song saying, worthy are you to take the scroll and to open its seals, for you were slain, and by your blood you ransomed people for God from every nation and every tribe and every language and every people, and you have made them a kingdom and priests to our God, and they shall reign on the earth. And then I looked, and I heard around the throne and the living creatures and the elders and the voice of many angels, numbering myriads and myriads, thousands and thousands, saying with a loud voice, "Worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and wealth and wisdom and might and honor and glory and blessing." Redeemed, Father, we come before you this morning, and we look back, and we know that when we were trapped in our sin, from which we couldn't save ourselves, Lord, we were captured by death's grip, from which we couldn't escape. Only through the power of your shed blood on a cross could a way be made for us to cross death's gap and to be brought into union with you again. Because of the power of your resurrection, you've given us new life. A life that's not just temporary, but eternal, that began when we received your grace. So, Lord, we worship you because of that. And we join the song, the chorus with the angels around the throne, the saints around the world, and the saints who've gone before as one people, one voice united, saying, "You alone are holy. Worthy is the Lamb, the perfect Lamb of God who was slain, that we might know you, that we might receive the good news of the gospel of grace." Lord, may you be glorified in this place as we continue to dwell on your greatness and your power, the power of the resurrection and your spirit in us. It's in your name we pray. Amen and amen. You may be seated.
Wow. Thanks be to God for the opportunity to worship him and to think that even as we were singing here, how many of our loved ones are singing in heaven on this day? How many of those in Christ who've gone before? What a glorious thing. Amy, thank you for leading us too with a great illustration of, you know, we just can't make it on our own, but thankfully someone came from heaven, from the stage. Kent is our safe way. I like it. I just thought that was perfect. We kind of feel that on staff. If something's going wrong, it's like, let's get Kent's take on it because he's got some depth. It's really helpful. Well, I want to encourage you, if you have your Bibles, to turn with me to Luke chapter 24, the resurrection chapter in Luke's gospel. All four of the gospels have the resurrection at the end of them. It's the whole point of each of the gospels. And I want to just read about 5.5 verses and then talk about them and invite you to consider Jesus. And then we're going to watch as several people give testimony that they belong to Jesus, and they want you and all of us and all the world to know it. So Luke 24, the chapter 23 ends with the Sabbath day and the women. They went to the tomb before when, or just as Jesus died, they went to the tomb and they got him all ready and they, you know, laid him gently in there, and then they had to rest because of the Sabbath. Now, 24 begins the next day, Sunday morning, on the first day of the week, at early dawn, the women went to the tomb, taking the spices they'd prepared. And they found the stone rolled away from the tomb. But when they went in, they didn't find the body of the Lord Jesus. While they were perplexed about this, behold, two men stood by them in dazzling apparel. And as they were frightened and bowed their faces to the ground, the men said to them, "Why do you seek the living among the dead? He's not here. He is risen." Amen. This is the word of God for the people of God. And we say, thanks be to God. Listen, the women came in the early morning to honor the Lord Jesus. What you and I don't know, because it's not part of our culture, is that in ancient Israel, there was a two-stage burial. A two-stage burial, when someone would die. And at first, the first stage is you'd wrap them, the corpse, in linen, cloths, and spice them, and you'd lay them in a tomb for about a year. Because the flesh has to decompose. The spices are to cut down on the stench of the decomposing flesh. And then about a year later, you would carefully, reverently go to the tomb, and what's left? No flesh, just bones. And you would take those bones carefully, you know, and you'd put them in a bone box. They just don't have enough room in that small country of Israel to bury the whole person forever. So they put 1 year, you lie in a tomb, everything decomposes, and now you're down to bones, and they put you in a small bone box. How big is the bone box? As big as your femur, that's it. No bigger. Two femurs, and then the rest just get put in there. So it's not that big. And then they take that, and that's your final resting place. Okay, that's what's going on. You and I don't know that. Now we know it. All right, so first stage of resurrection. On the Good Friday, when Jesus is taken down from the cross late in the afternoon, the Sabbath is about to begin. You know, Sabbath in Jewish culture starts at supper time. And it goes till supper time. So the Sabbath is about to begin, and Jesus is dead. And what are they going to do on Good Friday? Well, they dress his body with the linen cloths and some of the spices, and they lay him quickly but honorably. They lay him in the tomb, and then they go and rest in accordance with the Sabbath. And that's why they're so eager at first light on Sunday morning to get up and go to the tomb. Why? Because they did a rushed job on Friday afternoon, and they want to honor their loved one better. He's their teacher, their rabbi, their friend. They've watched him heal. And they say, well, if he's going to decompose over the next year, we want to make sure everything's done right. And probably also because in another gospel it says, maybe later on in Luke, Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of James, and that means Mary the mother of Jesus, because James is Jesus' brother. So Mary, you know, the Virgin Mary, the sweet, thinking to themselves, it's a way to comfort them, so comfort her. So they get to the tomb, and the stone is rolled away. Another gospel, they say they're wondering who's going to help them roll the stone away, but it's rolled away. And they go in this tomb. Now, here's what you need to know. A one-year holding tomb, which they'd reuse a bunch of times, it's not a big thing because it's dug into the rock, right? It's not a tent you put up. It's not a house you build out of wood. It's a cave you dig out of the stone. And so you're not going to dig it any bigger than you absolutely have to, right? And so you have maybe one or two places for bodies to lie and decompose and a little prep area. And you come in and that's all there is to it. So, Mary, and the other women. So that's at least two more, maybe three. So they're now all crammed in this little tomb. There's no body. And then who shows up? Now get crammed in the tomb with me here. Who shows up? Two, not one, but two angels sent from God's throne. So this tomb is getting pretty crowded. And they say, "Why do you look for the living among the dead? He's not here." It's amazing to think that that tomb now with seven people in it is still empty because he's not here. Why do you seek the living among the dead? He's not here. He has risen. I think this is the greatest question ever asked. As you think about the garden they're in and the other tombs around them, and they're in this tomb and the stone is rolled away, why do you seek the living among the dead? He's not here. And I think for the women, As the angels ask it, it's a rhetorical question. But for you and me and everyone later, it's an invitational question. What do I mean? What's the difference? Let's talk with the women first and then with us. Okay, for the women, it's a rhetorical question from the angels. It's a declaration, a message to them. What are they doing there again? They came to take care of the corpse. Isn't that right? Ooh, is exactly right. They came to take care of a corpse. Why? Because they watched him die. They laid him in the tomb. They didn't expect him to rise. Like every other person in history, they know that death is the end of every life. And the physical realities and the universal realities of death are true. And in spite of everything Jesus had said for 3 years, they couldn't imagine that God's power and his purposes were going to be as radical as they turned out to be. They couldn't imagine that this day they would see the end of death. So they came with their spices to properly care for the corpse, because they couldn't imagine a different outcome than what they've already known. So when the angel says to the women, "Why do you seek the living among the dead?" it's a declaration. I mean, it looks like a question, it feels like a question, it acts like a question, there's a question mark at the end of it, but really, it's a declaration of triumph. He's not here. He has risen. Those angels, they're not looking for answers. Hey, what are you doing here? No. They're saying, the living isn't among the dead. They're announcing that Jesus is raised back to life and death has no hold on him. The grave is open. The night is over. The new creation has begun. And sins are forgiven. And peace with God is now. Because he's not here. He's risen. Why do you seek the living among the dead? Now, it's a rhetorical question to them. It's a declaration, an announcement. But as I said to us, to everyone who's read it since then, do you know what it is? It's an invitational question. Why do you seek the living among the dead? What do I mean? What do I mean? Well, work with me here. Where do you seek in your life? Where do you seek hope and meaning and purpose from? What is it that drives you? What is it that leads you in life? In the hard times, the perplexing times, the hurting times, what is it that consoles you or comforts you? Where do you look? Where do you find value? Where do you find grounding? Now, when I look around our world today, our culture, when I read and watch and listen to the voices of our culture, you know what answer I hear most, and I think you do too? The answer we hear most to the question of where to find life and meaning, where to find true identity, do you know where it is? Our culture tells us, look inside. Look to yourself. The experts and the influencers and the leaders in our culture, the speakers who speak at us, they tell us, be true to yourself. They tell us, follow your heart. You can be whatever you want to be. No one can tell you how to feel. You make your own truth. Don't let anyone impose anything. This is the words of our songs and our movies and our interviews and our stories that we tell each other and that we see. Look inside yourself. You'll find your truest meaning there. Which means you are the defining reality of your existence. Or I am the source of my meaning. Now, there's a problem with this. Maybe more than one. The problem is that when I look inside myself, can I do a little confession with y'all? When I look inside myself, I don't find a perfectly noble and pure and powerful inner person. I find a guy who is at times confused, at times mistaken, at times indecisive. Maybe you see that when you look inside yourself. Sometimes we're capable of amazing things, but other times we're incompetent to do what we set out to do. Often we're gracious, and often we're petty or indignant. When we stop to reflect, do you ever hear a whisper that something's terribly wrong inside of us? Why can't we fully accomplish what we want to accomplish? What's wrong with me? Why can't I keep to that ethical standard I want to keep? Why do I fail again and again? We don't totally live the way we want to live. We say cruel words to loved ones, and we know it, and we hate it, and we regret it, and then we do it again the next day. We think filthy thoughts and hate ourselves for it, but we can't stop. We make devious plans to get on top in the situation, even though it goes against our conscience. Why do I do this? The answer is something's horribly wrong in our hearts. And I think the explanation is our hearts, our inner core, the center of our self, our true self, is dead in a spiritual sense. Everyone has a physical and a spiritual side to them or aspect of them. And we're alive physically, all of us. I mean, we're moving around, we're talking, we have personality and character, and this is all by God's design. But also, even deeper than that, our inner core, our central self, though alive physically, is dead spiritually. In other words, cut off from all the source of good and true and beautiful. Cut off from God Himself who created us in love. And if I'm cut off from the source of good and true and beautiful, and I look inside myself, that's why I can't always do the good. I can do it sometimes. I can't always do it. Because I see now I'm cut off from the source of good. I can't always be the better me that I want to be. I'm imprisoned. We are imprisoned in the tomb of our heart. We can't break free. We're dead. We can't cure our own heart disease. It's corrupted. We can't fix our own brokenness. Every human heart, every inner core is physically alive, but spiritually dead. And the one thing we know about a corpse is that it can't do anything on its own. So the world's solution, saying search your heart to find your true meaning, is going to lead to a dead end every time, because the heart you're searching is already dead. It can't give life. It can't give hope or give meaning or joy or peace. And God invites us with this question: why do you seek the living among the dead? God invites us. Why do you hope for lasting change from that which is decaying? How can you trust your heart when it's only ever failed you? Why do you seek life among the dead? And then He invites us to consider something new. What if your heart, what if your inner core, what if the central self could be brought back to life again, could be resurrected, no longer spiritually dead? What if instead of looking inward in your life, you looked outward for power from the outside? Why do you seek the living among the dead? He is not here. He has risen. Do y'all ever watch the medical shows, you know, New Amsterdam or back in the old days, ER or MASH maybe? I don't know. Was that a medical show? I don't know. But when the patient is on the operating table, in the middle of the surgery, and there's high drama, of course, some of you are really in the operating room, so here I am, you know, watching TV and you're doing it. So anyway, when the patient is on the operating table and they flatline, what does the doctor do next? They grab those paddles. I don't even know the name of the machine. They pop them on, and then what do they yell out? Clear! Why? Because they're about to jolt that heart to get it started again with power from outside. Do you know what the doctor has never done in the operating room when someone flatlines? He's never said to the patient, look within yourself for power. Never! You can't get there. What does he do? Clear! Because we need that power from the outside. And friends, God stands ready to infuse your heart with power like you've never known before. His resurrection power that raised his son to life. And he extends that offer to everyone today, for our lives today and our futures eternally. He will transform us from hearts dead in our sins to hearts alive in his Son. Do you want that today? How does that radical transformation come? Power and his new life resurrect this heart? Clear. When? I'll tell you when. It's when you obey a long list of rules and never make a misstep. Is that it? No, we've already tried that. It doesn't work. It's when you finally empty your mind of everything and achieve enlightenment on the eightfold path of enlightenment. Is that it? No, there's no hope there. It's when you finally give up in a big act of sacrifice to prove that you're worthy. Is that when God accepts? No, there's no hope there. It's me trying to make life out of my death. Oh no, the only hope we have when God's grace and power comes to you and to me and resurrects our hearts, our lives, and give us Christ's life, it comes at a single moment in our life, and that might be today for you if you've never thought this way before. It's the moment we believe that Jesus is the only one who can rescue us, and at that moment we also reach out to him for rescue. It's believing it, and it's reaching out to him for rescue. When you believe and surrender, when you trust his words and entrust yourself to his promises, when you give your life to the Lord who gave his life for you, that's when his grace and power infuses your life and radically transforms you with life from within that comes from above. Jesus stands today victoriously alive. See, his body never decomposed like it was supposed to in that culture. Never got there. Back to life. God's power to him. God's power to you today. Back to life. Your heart and the rest of your life utterly new. And Jesus stands today to invite you into his family, into his new life. How? Well, I'm going to pray to him. And if God is inviting you to believe in him today, I want you to pray this where you are. Pray it in your heart, but pray it from your heart. There's no magic in the words. You know, we don't believe in magic spells. That's not true. But it's just a heart talking to our Heavenly Father. And if I want you to pray where you are, just after me in your heart, maybe you've never talked to God before, but you know today he's inviting you to believe in him and to reach out to him. Pray with me right now. Father, I have been looking for life among death. I see now that it only comes from you. Through your crucified and risen Son, Jesus, who loved me. Lord, I see now that I've sinned and I can't stop on my own. So I ask you to forgive me and cleanse me and receive me into your family. Please, as you promised, give me your spirit to live in me forever. Lord, I've been physically alive, but I see I'm spiritually dead on my own. Raise me with Christ. I believe in him and I stake my life on him. Amen. Friends, if you prayed that prayer today, I want to invite you to tell someone. We're about to watch several people tell you they prayed that prayer at some time in the past. They belong to Jesus. He's given them a new life. And if today you gave your life to Christ, will you tell someone? Tell someone next to you. Tell me or Ben or Dr. Rob or Kent or any of the worship team. Tell someone, because other people want to help you love Jesus more and live with him more. This life is together. Why do you look for the living among the dead? I don't anymore. He is risen. He is risen. Well, the life that starts in our inner selves with Jesus now, his power in us, it continues out to the rest of our lives and our conduct, our character, our lives. And so Jesus gave us baptism as a symbol, as a reenactment of our death in our old self and new life in him. Everyone you'll see is going to go down into death symbolically underwater. You can't breathe underwater. But they're going to be raised symbolically by outside power to newness of life. And guess what? They're going to come up all wet, as it were cleansed, but also wet, as it were, the Holy Spirit flooding their lives. I mean, this is a beautiful picture that he gave us. The old life is dead. The new life is now in Christ Jesus. So what I'd like to do is invite Ben, if you would come on up, and he is going to baptize the first few people. And then let me do this, actually. As we transition to this, let's pray together as we watch Emma, Lisa, and then Elijah first get baptized. Father, we thank you for all that you've done in our lives. And we pray even now, as these several brothers and sisters are coming to you to be baptized, we ask that you would grant that all of us would be encouraged by their stories of faith, by their lives of faith, by their witness and testimony. They belong to you. So we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen and amen.
Good morning, everybody. Today, as you guys know, I mean, just getting to see this is a day of celebration for so many. And one of the cool things, one of the things I always love about baptism is just getting to see all the different ages. And what is so cool is today we just have so many people from so many different seasons, but all come into the tub for one reason, right? And so what I'd love to do is, Emily, I'd love to invite you first. Yes. Here, you can just leave them right there, yeah. They're not his size, are they?
Yeah.
Okay. All right, and you'll just come down here. You'll sit down, yep. All right. Emma, Lisa, your verse today is Psalm 143:8. It says, "Let me hear in the morning of your steadfast love, for in you I trust. Make me know the way I should go, for to you I lift up my soul." Amen. So I have three questions for you, and none of them are trick questions, I promise.
Okay.
I've saved those for your brother.
Yeah.
So here's the first one. Have you trusted Christ as your only Savior?
Yes.
Have you surrendered to Him as your Lord? And do you declare that you want to live each day by the power of the Holy Spirit in you? Amen. Praise the Lord. All right, well, grab my hand. Yep. Upon the profession of your faith, I now baptize you in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. All right. Let me help you out. All right, Elijah. All right, down here. All right, Elijah, your verses for today is Psalm 16, 6 to 8. The lines have fallen for me in pleasant places. Indeed, I have a beautiful inheritance. I bless the Lord who gives me counsel. In the night also my heart instructs me. I have set the Lord always before me because He is at my right hand. I shall not be shaken. My prayer for you is that that is always to be true. So three questions for you, Elijah. Do you want the same ones or do you want the harder ones? All right, we'll go the same, yeah. So the very first one, have you trusted Christ as your Savior?
Yes.
Have you surrendered to Him as your Lord?
Yes.
And then do you declare that you want to live each day by the power of the Holy Spirit who lives in you?
Yes.
Amen. All right, well, upon the profession of your faith, I now baptize you in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Rashawn, come on up here, Wally and Rashawn.
Way to go.
All right, next, Rashawn, you're next. You can just keep on walking.
Love you, brother. I'll hold your towel for you.
Rashawn, your verse is Proverbs 3, 5, and 6. It says, trust in the Lord with all your heart and do not lean on your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge Him and He will make your path straight. Such a great verse, and that is my prayer, that every day the Lord will make your path straight. So, three questions. Have you trusted Christ as your Savior?
Yes.
Have you surrendered to Him as your Lord?
Yes.
And then do you declare that you want to live each day by the power of the Holy Spirit who lives in you? Well, Rashawn, upon the profession of your faith, I now baptize you in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen, man. All right, Mr. Wally Burge.
Good morning. He's risen. I just wanted to say a few words. Early this year, when I started my quiet time in my Bible study, I decided to read the New Testament. And each time I read the book of Matthew, Mark, and Luke, when they described Jesus' baptism, I couldn't explain it, but I felt something deep inside saying, you need to do that. And so many times we read things in the Bible we don't understand, but we have this voice telling us to do something. So I felt like I had to do this. I was sprinkled as a young boy in the Methodist Church. It was a glorious day. I don't think I've ever seen my parents so happy. But as a teenager and a young adult, I wandered very far away from the Lord. And I think through my mom's prayers, my dad's prayers, I eventually made that journey back, and he's been with me every day. He will be with me until I die, and I just want to serve him the time that I have left on this earth. So praise God, he's risen.
Amen. Yeah, you can keep those on. Well, Wally, you cheated. You didn't let me pick a verse for you. You made sure you picked it yourself. And I think you picked one of the best ones. So your verse is Romans 8:28. And we know that for those who love God, all things work together for good, for those who are called according to his purpose. Amen. So, three questions, Wally. Have you trusted Christ as your Savior? Have you surrendered to him as your Lord?
I have.
And do you declare that you want to live each day by the power of the Holy Spirit who lives in you?
Grace be to God, I will.
Love you, brother. Upon the profession of your faith, I now baptize you in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Let me get you, can help you up.
Well, we're doing a changing of the guard here as Dr. Rob comes in, one of our elders and shepherds, and he's going to lead the next two guys being baptized. And this is Jacob Jones, and so Jacob's going to share his story. So you look that way. That's right.
Happy Easter, everybody. So to tell a long story short, mine begins back in February 2021 when my marriage ended unexpectedly and completely caught me off guard. I was married for almost 11 years. And fought hard for those 11 years to keep my marriage. And I must be honest, it broke me as a man and put me in a dark place in my life. I did not know what I didn't do what I should have done, which is taking my time to heal and come to Jesus Christ and God for guidance. For the first couple years during my separation and divorce, all I did was drink every night, go out and just party all the time. And not realizing all I was doing was trying to fill a void inside me, that emptiness and that loneliness and that hate I had for the world at that time. Then I met some special people that came in my life during that dark time who helped show me that there is never a void inside us, that I can never be empty, and I would never be alone because Jesus Christ and God and their sacrifices for me and all of us. Amen. And because of their sacrifices, they will always be with me and will never forsake me. Till this day, I know in my heart that God and Jesus bring people in our lives and work through others to open our eyes, our hearts, and our souls to our Lord Jesus Christ. I've been coming to Grace now for a better part of 2 years. And now I do daily devotionals. I read the scripture daily. I pray daily, but not just only for myself, but for others as well. I'm now in the middle of the Freedom of Christ discipleship, and I'd like to personally thank Dr. Rob for his kindness, his patience, his understanding, and for his hope and faith. All these things I never would have even considered a couple years ago, but now I've found my new identity in Christ. All the things I've been battling all those years that I felt so alone and lost, but now I know that even though I may have felt like I was in a dark place, that Jesus Christ and God are always with me. And I know that I have been accepted and that I am significant and I am secure in Jesus Christ and God. So I am here today to announce publicly to my family, to my church family, to Jesus Christ and God, and yes, even Satan himself, that I'm devoting my life to Christ. But knowing it's not because of how I may behave or my actions on my worst days, but because of what I believe in my heart. And that is my faith, hope, and devotion of Jesus Christ and God.
Amen.
To anyone here hearing my testimony today, I would like to say to you this. Never give up your faith and hope, and because he didn't, and he lives in all of us. Amen.
Amen.
And Dr. Rob let me choose my own life verse today.
Oh, I love it.
So I decided to go with Ephesians 2:10. For we are God's handiwork, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared advanced for us to do.
Amen. Amen.
There we go. What a privilege it's been to be to get to know this brother in Christ. I'm just so excited for him and also his enthusiasm to really dig into the Word. What a blessing to me personally just to have this privilege. There are three questions you've heard already.
Ready?
Have you trusted Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior?
Yes, I do.
Have you surrendered your life to Him as your Lord and Master?
Yes, I do.
Do you declare now that you desire to walk in the power of the Holy Spirit now and forevermore?
Yes, I do.
Upon the profession of your faith,
yes,
Jacob Jones, I now baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
You share.
All right, cool. Good morning, church. So I'm Mike with Longhorn. My participation in today's baptismal service.
Hang on, let me double check here.
I got a big voice anyway, so anyway. My participation in today's baptismal service is a personal decision to be obedient to what I believe to be God's plan for me. I find it imperative. So I find it imperative to openly profess my faith in Jesus and announce my commitment to accept Him as my Savior. Recently, I have really been in awe, guys, really. I've been in awe that the Creator of this entire universe, cares enough for me. To save me and redirect my life under His plan of salvation. Guys, I have such gratitude for that. It's amazing. After living my past adult life as a self-reliant individual, I have now learned the freedom that is available to all of us. You guys too. All of us who choose to walk with Jesus. Recently, God has sovereignly shown me that being a seemingly, quote, nice guy or a good old boy is just not sufficient. Simply put, I've learned that a good old boy will likely fall short of a heavenly eternity. So, today, church, amid our congregation here, I commit to living a future that is inclusive of Jesus Christ and less self-reliance and self-indulgence. So, with this commitment today, I've adopted Philippians 4:19 as my life verse. And my God, and my God will meet all your needs. Wow. All your needs according to the riches of His glory in Jesus Christ.
Six months ago, when we got together, bit of a crisis, but God has sovereignly brought you through because He loves you. He has a plan for you, and he desires to walk with you day by day. Even this week, you learned that he's promised never to leave you nor forsake you. You've learned a lot. You've grown a lot in Christ Jesus the last 6 months. You know your identity in Christ. You know that you've been pardoned from all your sins. Therefore, there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. You've been adopted into his family. You're now a citizen of his kingdom, of heaven, eternally, and now. And you've been given a new title, one none of us deserve, that of being a saint, a holy one, made righteous by the blood of the Lamb Jesus Christ. We worship today. Mike, there are three questions to ask. Have you trusted Jesus Christ to be your personal Savior?
Yes, I have.
So good. Have you surrendered your life to Jesus as your Lord and Master?
Absolutely, I have.
Do you now declare that you desire to walk in the power of the risen Lord, his Holy Spirit, daily?
Yes.
Upon the profession of your faith, Mike McLonghorn, I now baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and the Holy Ghost.
It's a joy to celebrate with Mike and all the rest and with all of us on this Easter day. And as we continue kind of to sing ourselves out into the world, let us rejoice thinking that God has brought to himself through many dangers, toils, and snares, but he's brought to himself each one who belongs to him. And it's all because of the risen Jesus. So let's sing again. Stand with us as we sing.
Stone rolled away from the door.
we have just sung our faith. That's what we have sung. We've sung the gospel. So now let's pray for these, our brothers and sisters who are baptized today as we leave. Father, we are so thankful that living he loved me, dying he saved me, rising from the dead he rolled our sins away, and that one day the trumpet will sound and our Lord Jesus Christ will come back, this risen, conquering Savior. Father, we are thankful today for the witness and testimony of Emelisa and Elijah, for Rashawn and Wally, for Jacob and Mike. And Father, we don't just give you thanks for them, but as a body, we pray for them. We ask that you would fill them anew with your Spirit, with his humility and reliance on you. Oh God, we pray for each of these who have given testimony today. And Lord, we ask that you would lead us out into your world, the world you love so much. We pray that we would be the people of resurrection as Christ is in Jesus. And so receive now the benediction from God on this resurrection day. Now may the God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus, that great shepherd of the sheep, by the blood of the covenant, may this God of peace equip you with everything good that you may do his will, working in us that which is pleasing in his sight, through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory this day and forever and ever. Amen? Amen. Amen. Go in resurrection hope.